Well, I was christened Carminia, Lourdes, Cynthia, Arnaldo, Gutierrez. Carminia was the religious name of my mother, who was a former nun of the Franciscan Missionaries of Mary. And she was a nun for 10 years. And 1 month before the final vows, she fell, broke her back, was sent here, had an operation, and after much dialogue and discernment, left the order, but continued on with her missionary zeal. She really wanted to serve the kingdom of God. For her, souls for the kingdom of God was essential, was everything in her journey. My father is a botanist, a taxonomist, and so you can imagine how our tables were very animated and colorful. You know, God's creation and the integrity of His creation, Him being present in all life, and at the same time, my father giving his own spirituality and expressing his own way with God, and in the way he chooses, in the way he communes with nature. He says, "Is the weed good or bad?" He would ask. I would say, "But everything that the Lord created is good." Okay. But you must learn how to segregate the poison from the medicine. Okay. Just like people, you cannot judge. There is poison, there is medicine. But does God destroy everyone? In the end, what is good will be reaped. That's what my mother would say. And what is not resonant will be burned, will be... buried. So I grew up with songs, with dreams, with stories, with conversations like this, witnessing my parents' lives. My mother took on her missionary vocation in giving retreats, recollections. She was an artist, so she continued on. And it was a very creative and spiritual journey with her. With my father, it was very interesting as well. He made me see the proof of love. He said, "There's love, God is love, but nature is the proof of His love." So when he would come from the forests and would tell me that they're taking away the trees, our paradise is getting lost, the Philippines is... such a paradise to biologists and nobody understands. And then this was like in the backdrop of a lot of political problems, and there was a dictatorship going on, and everyone was in a flux in a conflict of personal vocations and personal security. Yeah. My father would say, "I'm a scientist, I will do my science in the forest, even if they doubt that I am already taking care of the rebels." All I want to do is to share with them medicine that is given to us in the forest. The alternative to medicine is the forest. You don't have to get sick if you know what the forest can give to you. And nobody was listening to Materia Medica in those days. Only now, you know, only now a lot of people are, at least here in the Philippines. So, and growing up here with my grandmother as well, see, my parents were always on missions. I was most of the time here with my grandmother, who would go to church every day. We would go to the Passionist priests there. They had a Mass every day, two houses away. I grew up in this place that had hardly any houses, full of fields, carabaos. I would wake up the flies at 5:30 in the morning. Wake up. It seemed like a charmed life, but really everything was always in a rush. Everything was always changing. I changed schools every year, and then by the time I reached my college years, this was in Miriam College, right again, 2 blocks away. I had to confront the question of the existence of God in our philosophy class. And I, believe it or not, it actually touched a core in my being. The fact that we could question the existence of God in a very Catholic school. And maybe nobody noticed it, but I approached my professor and asked, I know this is for the grade, but is anyone going to take care of my soul while I'm at it? While my mind is trying to convince myself and to find proof that God does not exist, does not God hear me? And is anyone going to be responsible for my soul? And he smiled and he said, continue, continue. You're entering something very interesting and beautiful. So pursue that even as you try to make the grade. For some reason, I understood what he meant. And that was the, I think, the awakening of consciousness for me. The quest has begun. And I spoke to Hashem, to our Heavenly Father, to the source of all life, and that made me become and exist, and said, I would like to be true to you, and there's more beyond that we can all comprehend, and what we are conditioned to believe is probably a beginning, and but truth is the journey that you want us to all take. And just like a father to a child, to his daughter, he would love that his daughter knows him personally and truly, not just know about him, about his science, about his works, about. And so I said, yes, I will take that journey. I will not turn my back on anything. I will just expand myself and let you form me and mold me. Yeah. I guess that's, well, then I wanted to become an investigative journalist, so I took up communication arts. And after college, while I was in college, I was doing already some commercials and modeling. And after I graduated, I auditioned for Noli Me Tangere. It's a television series based on our national hero's novel, Noli Me Tangere, Touch Me Not. He was a doctor, but also a revolutionary. But his pen was his mark of peace, you know, his contribution to our country. And Noli Me Tangere for me was sort of like a scientific and anthropological study, of a spiritual study of our society in those days, in the late 1800s. And as a doctor, it's no wonder he diagnosed our society to have cancer. So this is the cancer of our society today. How are we going to be tomorrow? And that was more than 100 years ago, when people didn't really have access to education or to the existence of consciousness, or, but we had our native intelligence that was always there, the soul that knew. And I think Jose Rizal had perceived that soul, that Filipino soul that was untouchable. And it was his expression to tell others, we have a soul that will refresh us, sustain us. And so it was not an accident that I played the part of Maria Clara, and I was accepted in that television series. And then I was confronted with the question, do I continue on with current events, with what I've studied, or what am I really trying to investigate? Back to philosophy class. question of God, question of truth, the question of why am I here, who am I, where am I going, and if I'm going anywhere, how do I get there? I guess I'm trying to investigate the human condition. So after 2 months of being in an authentic family of directors, writers, actors, people talking about culture over lunch and dinner, people talking about Jose Rizal. Thanks. The trees are saying hello. That gave me some discernment time, 2 months of discernment time. If God is leading me into this business or this industry, let it be a way for me to find Him. And because showbiz was really not the safest path to take. And by grace, I knew that. I knew that. But I didn't know what showbiz was all about. So the culture of materialism and masks and illusions was surrounding us, but I feel that if that the artist knows its soul, then we can still use the medium and preserve that integrity in any project, in any. I found ways, and the Lord had showed me ways. I mean, the spirit of life, Hashem, has shown me ways to use that medium wisely and make decisions with a very. I'm not an authority in filmmaking or in the showbiz life, or. But for some reason, I was guided by the right people, the right circumstances to make the right decisions. And then 15 years ago, I was invited to an environmental concert. Artists, sculptors, painters, they all came together in the Rizal Stadium, again, Jose Rizal, with a theme. To heal the environment. Took 100 years, less than 100 years, to destroy what took billions of years for nature to build and to grow. Let us pledge as artists now to heal the environment in the next 100 years or so, symbolizing our lifetimes. To heal, yes, because that means we have to double time. There are deadlines to meet. Scientists are already warning us. In our lifetime, we will be experiencing really the effects of this neglect. So it's not just about survival. I realized in the last 15 years, environmental issues and the movement, it's not just about our human rights to live and sustainably. It's also about our sanctification. It's also about our sacredness. It's all about knowing we are home and treating one another as part of home, not just people, but every being that has life is part of our sacredness. We destroy our sacredness when we destroy any part of nature. So I said, maybe, just like my father said, no? Describe the forests. Right now I'm looking at, just like all the thousands of species in a rainforest, we can't continue fighting each other. We have to start looking at ourselves as a community. How to find that common union? How to find that common unity, our community? And like a thousand species in a rainforest, we realize that survival and love should be a communal affair. And like what my father said, there is love and there's proof of love. Now I know this, how shall I live this truth? And there could be 100 good ways to live this truth, but what does God want for me? And so I took a 3-year journey, year 2000 to 2003, around the Philippines to meet real people, to meet people from the other side of the lenses, and to readjust my lenses and to really see with another kind of lens. I listened to their stories, their dreams, I collected their lullabies. And it was in the way of their offering the lullaby, their concern. For example, I interviewed this. She was a priestess of Mount Kitanlad, wife of a datu. And she was asking, why are you interested in our knowledge? And I said, I'm also Filipina and I don't know this knowledge. And I would like to share that with our generation, because looking at how you took care of Mount Kitanlad, it's so sacred, it's still so green, you live sustainably. Of course, there was an interpreter. And then she said, do you realize even a lullaby is knowledge from the ancestors? I said, yes, I believe that's part of our sacred story, our one story. And I know it's true. A mother cannot sing with a false heart to her child. And so that song must be true, must be a song of truth. And then she smiled and she said, okay, do you have 1 meter white cloth, 1 meter red cloth, 3 chickens with you? I thought it was like a test, but I think she wanted to see how my disposition would be given that question. Who knows? I don't know why she asked me. And I said, I wish I had something to offer you the way you want it. But I don't have those now. But I promise to come back and give you those if I could be given that chance. I said, okay, never mind. If you have 10 1-peso coins in your pocket or in your bag, don't ask anybody else. So I looked in my bag, and by grace, I had 10 1-peso coins. And this was a mystery. And I accepted simply as a mystery. And I offered it to her, and she smiled. We prayed. She had apparently been communicating with the ancestors in the prayer. And then she started to sing the song. For a lullaby, what guardianship, you know. She was really, and then I realized she was the keeper of their culture, the light of their culture. I had never knew that, but I'm glad I followed moment by moment with her. She was like a river. You just go with the river. Then you're one with the river, and there's no good or bad, you are. And then I said, this was the funniest thing. I had a piece of paper that was like a waiver, and she was supposed to sign it or give a thumb mark print to prove that she had given me the song and allowed me to sing and share it with people, because we had an indigenous people's rights. And I really felt embarrassed to explain that to her, because I'm sure she knew about those rights, those written rights, but she smiled and she laughed and she said, what do you need a piece of paper for? The ancestors had already given it to you. What proof do you want? And then so I said, well, I have a recorder. I will just explain that to the cultural guardians here in the city, in the commission here, and say that Would you want me to go and impose my culture on her or our, or would I accept it? So that was listening. Everyone is a universe. Everyone is a planet. Everyone has something beautiful, and it's not about laws. It's about acceptance. It's about, I'm giving you something beautiful. Accept it as it is. God is beautiful. Accept God as God is, as Hashem is, as Allah is. Om Shanti. As we are like all connected, like beads of a rosary. In the Christian and the Catholic faith, the rosary is a Paschal mystery that Our Lady had accompanied her son, and is being shared to us. We enter the sorrowful mystery. That's part of our lives. We enter the joyful mysteries. That's part of our lives. We enter the glorious mysteries. So we're joyful in birth, with this life, with all the abundance of nature, the abundance of relationships, community, ideas, creativity. Then we all also together in our sorrowful mysteries. Sometimes we don't have to solve those questions, but accept them as mysteries and enter on another level of understanding that. And then we are one, even if we had very different situations. And then there are the glorious mysteries of rebirth and healing and enlightenment, and how did we get to meet? For example, how did this beautiful journey you are on get to string all of our faiths together? And I'm sure all those people that you've met are now also having been enriched, are enriching others with the experience. So there's the luminous mysteries. It's very new, an additional part of the rosary, you know. And it's all about the light of Christ. And what is the light of Christ? Not just from a religious perspective. The light, the sun, that brings light to all the planets in the solar system, that the light that's inside all of us, in each of our cells. The light of humility that you experience in nature. Nature never asks for anything in return. And even if you step on the soil, or if you plant thousands of seeds in one given place, in one given time, even if it will cause an imbalance to nature, humble nature will not get in the way. Humus comes from that word, no? Humility comes from that word, humus, the life-giving soil, that layer on the ground where everything, life and death meets, where we, life, decay, death, life, part of our soul, the soil of our bodies, part of the water of our bodies, the air, the energy of our thoughts and our feelings, we are. So, I'm sorry, I really went into more of myself in, out and in, but
I'm swimming with the river.
That's the river, yes. And
that day when you said to the teacher, who's going to protect my soul?
Oh, yes, my professor.
Yes.
Will be responsible for my soul while I'm at it.
Tell me more about that experience, that time. Like, because the first question I often ask people is, what's your earliest memory of faith? So was that your earliest memory of faith, or was something else?
Oh, it was, well, since I was born, I guess, since I started to listen to my mother, my father, my grandmother's faith witnessing. You know, that was my first contact with faith.
What was your first personal experience that you had faith? or might have faith. Or
I was grade 2, and we were preparing for our Holy Communion. And I've always wondered, when will that time come when I can receive the host, Jesus, to Bread of Life? Of course, I knew it was a... I believed that the species was alive. You receive according to how you believe. Mm. If you think it's symbol only, then it's a symbolical species made out of flour and water, maybe, or what. But if you believe in the blessing and that you are receiving Christ, if I can pray grace over food and we will believe that the food is blessed by the Spirit of Life, Christ, God is blessing the food, and even that, especially in a sacramental way, we are receiving Christ. And as a child, I said, when will be that time? And so we were taught how to pray the rosary. It was not the prayers itself or the outward ritual itself, but when I had to pray on my own alone to learn the rosary, I felt that spirit moving already. I felt the presence of Our Lady with me. That moment when I was kneeling on the bed and half falling out. And, was it already 10 beads? Or was it... I was only maybe 9, 8 years old. And I think that was one of those personal, intimate moments experiencing or encountering that the Spirit of God was with me, present. There must have been an earlier one. I think I was 7 years old. I used to go to Mass with my grandmother here every morning. Father Justinian would give the Mass, and I had questions to ask him. And he said, well, Christ came to give us eternal life. One day, he passed away. And he was the man I was always asking these questions, spiritual questions. And he was asleep in a box where he fit in the chapel. And I asked my grandmother, what's he doing in a box? Oh, he's sleeping. He has to go now. You know, like an astronaut, go to another planet. He has to go now to heaven. I said, no, that means he died. He died. I thought we were going to have eternal life. So that question disturbed me. I still want to believe we will have eternal life without dying. That's...
Say more about the experience of preparing for the First Communion and feeling the presence of Our Lady in you. Can you go back to that time and tell me more about that? What did it feel like, and what do you remember?
I told her, well, she was like a mother. She is a mother, we were told. But at that moment, I approached her like a daughter. I said, teach me to be good and to be like Jesus. Because you were a good mother, because he was a very good son. And thank you, I said, thank you. Now I can receive him. And I don't know how to pray the rosary very well now. Not like my grandmother, very expert, like playing the piano. She was a pianist, so I considered myself as learning how to play the piano with her. So now I'm also learning how to play the rosary, to pray the rosary. And I was confident that she was listening. And there would be moments in my life journey, spiritual journey where I would reflect and see that she was always there in the most crucial, precarious moments of my life. Our Lady always was there and gave always a way to a way out, a way that is clear. She brings us to a point of clarity. Like when I was taking care of my mother for, let's say, 10 years, and that was a big preparation, and I am very grateful for that. No one will, it's very difficult to know what it means to accompany a person who is with a chronic illness. It's not about the illness, the medicines, but the unveiling of the soul, the ripping off of you know, she was stripped of everything, her friends, her comfort, until she was literally like being jailed in her body. But with a smile and with her eyes all conscious, and I said, so I asked Our Lady, what do I do? What would be the right disposition? What should be my attitude here? And I was contemplating that thought and that question. And call it a vision, an audible voice, or a very, it's audible and visual at the same time. I heard it, and she said, what if I was your mother on that bed? Then I that's all I heard, and then I realized heaven is on earth, you know? God shows us, reveals to us how He is also our mother through our mothers, how He is truly our father through our fathers. And we are, all of us are each a principle of motherhood and fatherhood to all life. And see, that's how I feel Our Lady has accompanied me. And then in reflecting on this environmental movement, Mother Earth, our mothers, Mother Earth, Mother Nature, our Divine Mother, God as our Mother, I believe we've entered another age, another cycle of our humanity and our spiritual journey together. Entering really that the female principle or the mothering principle of our Creator. And yeah, it's not at random that when we are prompted in our souls to, or called for a certain part of the journey, there's parts of the journey and there's the whole journey in itself. When we actually say yes, you know, we are saying yes to a collective, we are saying yes to a community. We bring the community with us. So whether it would be to work for the environment and to preserve our sacredness and in nature, to remember and stop the dismembering our relationships with all beings, all creatures. These are not commodities alone. Who wants to be called a commodity? And that they really are our brothers and sisters by birth, by virtue of just being born on earth together. We are in one home, one mother. And somehow God wishes us to know Him. I don't think He wants to remain a mystery for us. Well, let's say in the Christ himself would call God Abba, Father. There are so many clues already about this relationship. And religion and traditions are ways, all paths to our common union. My mother would always say, whatever you become, jinn. Whatever you choose, remember that we have one purpose in life, and that is to remember our way back to God. And in December 2006, I have been. It was a very crucial moment for my mother and I. We were in and out of the ICU, the ER. She was really collapsing. Her body was in a collapse. Everything was, if it was not her kidneys, it was her heart. If it was not the blood pressure, it was water spilling out of her cells. I say, this is a microcosm of Mother Earth today in a very critical condition where not one ecosystem is more or less, all over the world. That treating one area, one ecosystem, might do harm to another. We have to take very, very crucial steps in how we address healing our land and our relationships, I believe. Because the Earth can live for another 1.5 billion years, but with global warming, climate change, can we as human beings survive as a species on Earth? So it's a very real mission, a very real journey as well. I brought it to the altar. I brought all of this to the altar. My God and my all, what is happening to your creation and what is happening to my mother? I see what is happening and what is my mission? Because I can't speak for others, but at least be accountable, be responsible for my soul's mission. The answer to that, the question with my professor, who will be responsible for my soul? At one moment, we really have to embrace that solitude and that silence and that reckoning with our divine origins. Where we come from, where we're going. And we have all that, that's our birthright to ask. And if there is a mission, I said, then so be it. If I have to articulate it, I know God knows my heart, my mind, but if I have to articulate it to make it the word, make it alive, let that be the first step. Yes, so be it. Let my words be the first movement of my acceptance, total acceptance. And total offering. And then a fast thought came, what if there are obstacles? Then take away everything that is not necessary. 8 days later, a fire razed our house and all our belongings to the ground, to ashes, black ash, everything. I woke up 3 o'clock in the morning. I was woken up. It was a very quiet fire. Not even the neighbors, nobody knew. And I opened the door of my bedroom and, oh, there's a fire. I close the door, go back to sleep. There's a fire. And I jumped over the banister because by that time the fire had tongues of fire. It was like from the floor to the ceiling. We're already there. It was mesmerizing. You get paralyzed to a certain extent. And I could almost hear the fire saying, we are here, we have arrived, but not for you. So get out as fast as you can. I just found my body was just following and I was hardly awake, but I knew what to do. I was looking at the fire. I landed on the floor downstairs, crushed my heel, compacted my spine. I was able to move by grace again. We carried my mother out to the garden. In minutes, the whole house was devoured by the fire. It was contained because it was built with stone. In the emergency room, I felt the first thing that entered my mind, oh, the offering has been accepted. And then, since I had the second to third degree burns, I could not even feel the pain, but I knew it was painful. But I somehow, my spirit was prepared for this and brought elsewhere in that communion with God, in that solitude with God. While the nurses were, I don't know, everything was bleeding, burning. I said, Hashem, Heavenly Father, what do I do? What do I have to do? And then the voice came back and said, what do you have to do? What do you have to do? I have a watch, so watch. I have a rosary, so pray. Watch and pray. I have the miraculous medal still strung on my, so bear witness. Watch, pray, and bear witness. Okay. And then there was a nurse who was patting my shin to comfort me. And that's when I started to realize where I was. It's like my spirit went back into my emotions was alive again. And then I said, who are you? You're comforting me so well. I was already teary-eyed at that time. I said, it's more painful what you're doing to me than the pain I'm feeling in my hands, in my burns. In my mind, his compassion was more painful. It was really, what is your name? And he said, no, I'm just a nurse. It does not matter. Just, you'll be all right. I'm all right, but I want to know your name. And he said, Spiritu. Okay. Watch, pray, bear witness in the spirit. Live in the spirit. Who's going to be responsible for my soul? Okay. The spirit. God. God is our soul. God is our... There's no more questions. Only God. No more answers. Only God. I have no knowledge, only God. I have nothing, only God. I have no vocation, only God. And then I tried to, well, just like everybody else, face the obligations caused by the fire, attend to things that have to be done, continue the contracts that have been made, at the same time discerning, where do you really want me to be? Where do you really want me to go? So I had three questions. What do I put to a close? What do I continue? And what do I begin? Accepting all of that without letting the shoreline design it. You know, the shoreline is so beautiful. Jesus always walks along the shoreline. It doesn't cut. It goes up and then it recedes. So if your life has to recede, accept the pace, the beauty of that receding. And then even when it has to rise, then accept to face that. You have to face new shores. You have to leap to the new life. And what do you continue? You don't cut communion with people, with life. Where you are. I remember another lady who shared with me her lullaby, and she said in her lullaby it means never regret that you were born. Show the world you deserve the cradle you were born in. And it goes like Pendoyog Nakararek Pendo yog me kagadaw ay kagob kalandag muwe bede am fig ven palasan bede fuyu em le muak faden de idai to me faden de ibo to me Nta sai fe u nga ngen go Nta sai fe ti na ne go Fe ni mu an fi dong go nen Fe ni mu an fi dong go nen So resonances of faith is that beauty of colors and like the shape of leaves and nature and flowers, different fragrances, those resonances of beauty and love and communion is all here with us. What the professor said, what the lady from Cotabato in the Upi Mountains said, we all want to be understood and to understand. We all want to love and to be loved.
Do you remember the lullaby that the woman gave you for 10 pesos?
For 10 1 peso coins.
Oh, yeah.
That was the lullaby I've been wanting to know authentically, because there are notated versions or written words, transliterations of it, but never really. Tilay un tadug un nanaw man tanunuk man jakit un pahayong ba tabanuwa kahindangan tajakit Un pahambilong ubanan hawan puyawanan tadilay un tadug un hananaw man tanuna man dilay un tadug un nanaw man tanuno man Let's walk in this home of gold, where it rains like gold. You don't have to go to another country, because in this country, you will have everything you need. So you come inside my arms, don't cry. If you want to be comfortable, don't cry. Come closer, hug me tighter, don't cry. You're home. Let's walk in this country of gold.
What do you feel like you learned on your 3-year journey?
There's a saying, when there's a will, there's a way. But what I learned was, when it's God's will, it is the only way. God is union, the way to our common union, our communion.
Do you feel like tell me about the time, the first time you feel like you had to rely upon God, or chose to rely upon God?
Chose. It was a... I've relied upon God all the time, though. As I seek the truth about our faith, you know, and the faith of all peoples out there, inside also. There's that space that no matter what is happening on the outer life, There's that space within that's always still, that seems to know, that is always silent, but it's all-knowing. There's that space in us, and I'm sure you've encountered that. And I believe everyone has that space, that sacred space, that sacred ground. Even children, mostly, of course, children, when you catch them daydreaming, you stop them. No, how do you know they're just daydreaming, useless thoughts? They are one with the cosmos, one with the universe, one with questions that we probably never realized are essential questions. And it's in that space where I feel my reliance on God the most. But it's not just a reliance one way or because I have a need. Union. And the union gets deeper. And God shows you that union gets deeper and wider.
Was there a time where you first realized this? Was there I know you said it, not just when you ask for something or have a situation, but was there can you recall the first time where you realized?
There were many first times. There were many beginnings, I think, stages. And, of course, childhood, adolescent years, there were those questions. There were, what path do I adhere to? Because the pressures outside were new, different, and were not so harmonious. There were conflicts, you know, between what I grew up with and what is being presented to me, and yet I have to find that peaceful path with everyone. As a child, as a teenager, experiencing so many things new, as an artist, as an actress, as an environmentalist, people have many agendas and intentions and good intentions and interests, and we have to honor all of that. But we honor everyone by being true to our intentions and where we're coming from. And that's where I had to do my homework and really rely on God's will for that. Because that creates impact on people. I think the strongest, let's say, considering the past, what the future lies ahead for, and then for now in the present, of course, who knows, this could be just another stage, you know. But I think it's when I was called for the environmental movement. This is where I found a real concrete sense of community working for a certain good, one good for the good of all. You know, we all need air, we all need water, we all need food to eat, we all need community, fraternity, we all need a chance to be heard. Environmental movement is not just about the physical garbage out there, but the inner garbage that we have to change. And that was very resonant with my spiritual journey. And I said, here is another way that Hashem is revealing Himself. God reveals Himself in community. When the community begins to not just think of themselves, but for the good of the community, then it's a mission. Then a vocation is growing here somewhere. Our purpose as soul is being manifested. If we catch it, if we allow it to be part of our soul's journey, or if we allow our souls to awaken in the outer journey. And that's when I had to consider what is truth, but also how to truly live it out.
So, when did you feel this call?
1999. December 1999, environmental concert that I was saying earlier. I said, what is this? This is a different kind of people power. It's not about a political problem. It's about a problem that for ages we have been facing. And let's say serendipity happens. I went to my grandfather's library and I found a book written just after the Second World War by Fairflower, a scientist or a figure in his time. And he was saying, we are facing a more fatal war that any human being has ever experienced, more fatal than any of the world wars that we have gone through. And it's the war we have waged against nature, because in this war, we will surely lose. That was just in the 50s, written in the 50s. And then it's so beautiful to see how our responsibility, we carry our ancestors, our forefathers, the giants. They are, you know, leaving it up to us now. What do we do with all of that? We have been given the freedom in, let's say, our evolution. Freedom is now in our hands. So what do we do with it? What have we been doing with it? People have lost lives. We know our history, our human history has gone through so much. Burning, purification. And now we're stepping into the light. Are we going to be afraid of it, or are we going to assume it? And your journey is an affirmation of the light being shown. So we really have to collaborate. What are we entering now? Another cycle. What is this cycle all about? Because there is one sure thing, change, and another sure destiny, which is if we continue the way we're going, living the way we're living, there seems to be no destiny there. Scientists are already showing us that we cannot survive in a very real flesh and blood way on Earth if we continue to live the way we're living. But it's not just about being ecological in a physical sense or in an economic sense, or being sustainable in a social economic sense, but we have to assume our spirituality. We have to assume are we human beings or are we souls?
Who is somebody you admire for their faith?
Well, there is a lot. You read about them in the scriptures, in the Granth Sahib, in the Holy Scriptures, the Holy Bible. Real warriors who had spirit. The Sikh, the Muslims, the Jewish race, the Israelites, and never forget the multitudes, more than as an actor, I know there are stars and there are guests and there are extras. Don't forget the extras, the multitudes, the simple girls that talk to kings, the simple men that fight the giants. That's you and I, all of us. Then there's Gandhi, who says, you be the change that you want to see in the world. There's Mother Teresa, never studied anything, but had total love for God and wanted to extend that love to everyone, and found God in the poor, the desolate, the abandoned. they're the God intoxicated masters that tie, that hold and give us that lifeline for our souls. No matter what mud we are in, no matter what swamp we are in, no matter what, because of what we do, no matter our grave sins, grave mistakes, there's that lifeline.
What are you most grateful for?
God. God is my gratefulness. When I, after the first fire, I was so when you lose everything, memories, everything, thing, you realize the things you're accustomed to needing, you really don't need anything. And it's easier said than done, but I want to share that, that it's true, you don't need anything. In fact, it's hard to become simple. Sometimes people don't allow you to be simple. Sometimes to be respectful and to keep the integrity of your community, you cannot allow yourself to be simple. Oh, many things. But when God frees you and allows you to become simple, then it's a gift, it's a grace. When He takes away the shackles and takes away that burden, that then what do we do with that freedom? That's the next question. So I said, when you lose everything, it's because the universe is welcoming you to become one with every being. So that's the chance, that's the gift. That so that we can be a gift to others. But that's the gift. If we don't use it, if we don't cooperate, no, it's not just use, we have to cooperate. It's following and leading. It's all at the same time.
What's your greatest wish?
My greatest wish? I never wished for anything great. I never did. So I don't. Really? So I don't know how to answer that question. But I don't know how to answer. Make me an instrument of peace. Make me, God, make me, and that I could help others too. I could help others, and we all helping each other achieve and fulfill what our soul wants to fulfill and achieve.
Do you have a message?
The most essential message is in all of us. We only have to listen, be still, and receive it and fulfill it. Fulfill that message.
When I show people the portrait of you, that we're going to make? What do you want me to tell them about you?
You will know. You will know. I have a poem I wrote when I was 6 years old. Maybe that child contains the message. The child had already knew the message. She said, I'll have to look for it. It was scanned before the fire, so somewhere, but it I would reflect on it. And she wrote, help everybody, it is time for the show. When we walk together, I wonder if you will be there. Please, don't be away. Please, be kind and good and beautiful to the children you see in your dreams. Every day, you have everything except me. So please, be kind to me. That's a six-year-old child wrote. Kind, good, beautiful. I think those are her very important principles. The way of beauty, the way of goodness, the way of kindness. And it's not about everything. It's like anticipating the new world. You give me a glimpse, or the journey you bring with the others that you have interviewed already. Presence, not just yourselves, but communities that you represent, and that gives us a feeling of entering together the same visions. It's a beautiful vision and unfolding, and it's a concrete species, no, of faith. It's a concrete. We are a creature. We are creatures together. I had dreams of many voices speaking different languages, different, but agreeing. And they were all saying the same word, speak it out, speak it out. I was lying down in the middle and they were all saying, speak it out, speak it out. And then the speak it out was like a multitude, 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 until it became like crickets, until it became like a, like thum, like a sound like that. I'll never forget that dream. That was right before the journey to look for the lullabies. Lullaby in a certain dialect of ours, in Mangyan, is Uyayi. U-Y-A-Y-I. So I call the album Uyayi. It's a collection of songs. But I placed also another disc with it. So you could hear the original, the authentic voices. So it's like a bridge. I found myself as an artist, just a bridge, trying to bridge our roots to our present situation, and that we have to draw from the wellspring. And the wellspring not necessarily is, let's say, where water is coming from, water is also coming from people. And our indigenous brothers and sisters are closely in that very beautiful oneness with nature and life. They don't even have a concept of illness. It's balancing, giving and receiving. There's no such thing as, I realized, nobody seems to be taking anything, but receiving, yes, but giving, receiving. So this is like a wellspring of our humanity, you know, our society. And we must draw from there and bring it to others. And through the songs, we become part of the river immediately. And we choose. We choose to live a fragrant life or leaving a stench behind. Really, isn't it? It's
well said.
Yeah.
Well, thank you so much.
Thank you also.
Thank you.
You know how fireflies are? They only meet one partner in life and they have to find the right frequency. I just remembered. So it's about coming to another level of being in tune with the earth. And if we are sensitive to that, we can accept even certain behaviors that were not there and then suddenly were there. It's just a matter of getting back that balanced frequency or that harmony. And we learn to give space, to move back. And it's wonderful to see how they move amongst themselves and how I was able to integrate with them. And it's transformative and participative. No one is really leading, no one's really just following. It's like a cadence of, and I think we miss this. We miss this family, this community. I saw glimpses of hope in attending an Eco Village design course. It's not just about designing the physical areas of an Eco Village, but designing redesigning, you know, our spirituality, our social way of dealing, decision making, and I think there are a lot of Eco Villages now around the planet, intentional communities. I guess they're not far from the early communities in the Bible, and the kibbutz, and the hippies, and religious communities. These are all intentional communities trying to make a better world. We can benefit much from seeing the beauty of our religions, rather than, well, I guess it gets deformed and distorted with when other intentions come in. When we try to define it according to, but they're actually in itself, in themselves, the inspirations, the divine inspirations. If we re-look and revisit them, they're all guiding us like children, no?
I like that term, the divine inspirations.
Yes. They are.
That's great.
They are. And that's why I also tried to, the next, well, it's still in progress, that other album I call Mater Vitae, Mother of Life. It's a...
So you published the first album?
Yes, yes.
And how many lullabies are on it?
Oh, 35 in the second disc. The first disc has 17. But they're that I recorded. So as a living witness, you know, that I may not be a Higaonon or an Ifugao kinswoman, but I'm a kins.
Yeah.
I'm kin in a way we can accept our indigenous soul together.
I love that you included the second disc. That's...
Yes, because we have to... How do you go back to the source?
Yeah.
If to reenact that to share that journey.
Has it been successful? Did people call for
yes.
it?
Yes, yes, I've been replenishing. I mean, I've had to reproduce, and this has manifested into concerts in Japan, in France.
Of the lullabies.
Of the lullabies. At the,
what's that? Did you sing before as part of your artistic acting career? Or
no, not officially. I would be singing once in a while for shows. Yeah. And but again, that was also like a trigger. I was faced with the offer to be a recording artist. And I said, this is a good, it's a grace, but this is what God wants for me. I said, everybody is, I just felt that my voice wanted to find something else. Because when you sing, you are, your soul is engaged, everything. So that's why I took that journey first. And then it brought me to a whole new other world, another.
Did you literally go on the road for 3 years, or you would take trips?
Take trips, because again,
it's not so different than what I'm doing.
It was quite complex. Yes, not so. That's why I was.
Yeah, because I have a job. Obviously, and I had to be in India last week, and I'm going to China next week, or at the end of this week.
And then you plan according to yes.
Yeah, and we just.
That's what I did. I had to do plays. I had to do films. I had to do television series. But then, Mary merged them with sometimes. I plan, and it's already wonderfully planned. I'll go visit the Mangyans in this particular weekend, this particular month. And then right before, like a week before, I am forewarned, and it's not a good idea to come because there's a tribal war, or there's an army somewhere, or it could be dangerous, or so, or the Datu is not there. In a ritual now, cannot be.
So you'd have to change.
Yes, yes. That's where I realized when it is God's will, it's the only way. Because I almost gave up.
Really?
Yeah, and I could hear other people saying, you're wasting your time, your money, your effort on this journey. But I had dreams, I had visions. It consumed me. It was like a child.
How did the original idea come to you, of the lullabies?
The environmental problems. I said, nobody wants to change. All the information is there. We have 30 years of Earth Day celebrations. We have everything on the net, but nobody seems to change. Nobody seems to care about nature, and you're laughed at most of the time as a tree hugger or as a said. People have to find an access, a reason to care. And so I said, well, maybe we have to know our people. And if we know they depend on nature to live, majority of our population depend on nature to live, that has something on our conscience and our consciousness to that has weight on our consciousness and our conscience, at least. And the fruit of that journey was more than I expected. It not only made people more aware of nature, we realize how beautiful our culture is, the indigenous culture is, and that we can pattern our sustainable lifestyles from learning from them. And if it's just, let's say, a microcosm in terms of the other countries, imagine other countries and their own indigenous. Again, there's a common union there. Suddenly, nationalism disappears. The borderlines disappear when you talk about indigenous communities. Contemplating death is something we seldom like to talk about or to share. But not in a morbid way or anything, but I feel it's very essential to really face that and contemplate. But just before the second fire, I was writing, and it just came. They say Jesus is the way, the truth, the life. But in when I was contemplating death in those as a way, it's you. It came out this way. Learn to die in God's way, into God's way, and then to practice dying into God's truth, and then to master death into God's way. And then even dying and death had their own. For die, you design, intervene, and you, I believe, express. Dying is about practicing decreasing into yeast, into the name of God. And then death, or mastering death, is to receive that rare darshan from a God-intoxicated person. Darshan, entering the art of travel. Heavenwards. That's mastering death into God's way. God's way is the way of life, the way beyond death. But first, we have to consider and contemplate death.
Did that, when the fire happened and you were here, did you think you were going to die?
No, I wrote that a few days before the second fire. I wrote that a few days before the second fire. I was in the farm when that happened. And when they woke me up 1:30 in the morning, your house has burned again. I was very still. I thought, oh, the Lord has accepted my offering. Once again, and clarity. Yes, let's go off-grid.
Should we make your portrait?
Sure, yes, okay.